in our awareness as persons, there's probably nothing more fundamental than our awareness of right and wrong and the responsibilities that come with that awareness. That we call conscience. This is a universal experience. All the cultures of the world have that same awareness. The sense of responsibility, sense of right and wrong, sense that a person can be a good person or a bad, evil person, the duties that come with being a person, our relationship with others. This is something that's taken for granted in the whole human family. The rules of right and wrong, we don't make up. We find them. We look for them. We have to learn them. We don't make them. They're there, and we're seeking to find them and to understand them. And we're challenged by them. As we come to grips with the issues of life, we realize the principles and the values and standards that are there, and we're challenged to measure up to those standards. Many cultures have the same metaphor to describe conscience. The conscience is like a divine voice in the depths of our being, as if somehow there's a call, a deep call in the depths of our being, making us aware of our responsibilities, make us aware of what is right and wrong. This is a very important question today. The world is in a moment of transformation and change, which probably has never occurred before. All the cultures of the world are being transformed, being affected by this change. And peoples who've lived for centuries and ages and many, many generations with traditions and values and standards now find all these things being upset. So that means that conscience becomes far more important in our personal life. Pope John Paul II said once, being a good person doesn't depend on just doing the right things. Being a good person depends on owning values, on making those values your own, shaping your personality by the values you own. This is why it's so important now in this topsy-turvy world for people to understand conscience and take up the responsibility of conscience. Now, because of this changing situation in the world, there's much discussion of conscience. When people lived in very stable societies with standards and values that were taken for granted, it wasn't so complex. And the urgency of understanding conscience and applying conscience wasn't there. But in today's world, it is far more pressing. And we'll find the Second Vatican Council has taken up this challenge. And for the first time in official teaching, the place of conscience has been stressed in the official teaching of the Church. Now, I'm going to give you an interpretation of conscience that is traditional. It's the interpretation of leading Catholic thinkers. Thomas Aquinas, the greatest thinker of the Middle Ages, one of the greatest thinkers the Church has ever had, been upheld as an authority age after age in the Church, and Cardinal Newman in the 19th century, a giant. You know his story. He was an Anglican clergyman, as a scholar, a historian. He thought his way into joining the Catholic Church. He's recognized as an outstanding thinker, a tremendously rich mind, most insightful mind, and in touch with the realities of ordinary people's lives. These two great thinkers agree quite clearly in the essentials of what conscience is, and I want to explain that for you so that we can understand what precisely conscience should be in our lives. Both of these thinkers avoid two extreme positions. One of them is very common. Perhaps you have it. The idea that conscience is like a blueprint that we all have And if we're honest and look into our hearts when we're contemplating some action, we'll know whether it's right or wrong. Both of these thinkers say there's no complete blueprint. The other extreme, far more common today, is that conscience is so personal. My own personhood. No one could quite understand who I am and where I am in my life. When I make my judgment of conscience, no one can really evaluate it. The decision I make is really so personal that it's unique to me. They're both very different views, at one extreme, as it were, and one the other extreme, and they avoid both of these. Now, for both of these thinkers, conscience is a very complex process, arrives at a judgment about this action that I'm thinking of doing. Let's trace through the stages of that complex process, then we'll look at those different stages in more detail. They say, conscience begins in an awareness of very general principles of right and wrong, of good and evil. These principles, they say, are self-evident. If we really understand what's involved, they impose themselves on any person in their right mind. But these principles are very few and very general. The next stage is what St. Thomas calls moral science. Could be a misleading term, because it sounds as if it's the work of academics. What he means is a reflective understanding that applies these general principles to the complexity of life, how complex life is. Scarcely any two actions that people do are exactly the same. Their circumstances are different, their background is different, and all that they bring to the action is different. This moral science begins in tribal societies. They apply these general principles, as we'll see. As human cultures develop, they become more sophisticated, far more critical, far more carefully worked out. From that application comes the final act of the process of conscience, making a judgment. This particular action that I'm thinking of performing, or this attitude that I have, and I wonder whether it's right or wrong, I make a judgment as to whether it is right or wrong. Having begun with the most general principles and applied it to the complexity of life, we arrive at a judgment about that particular action. And then a person acts. When the person acts, whether they are a good person or a bad person in this particular action depends upon whether they followed the judgment of conscience or disregarded it, whether they acted according to their lights. A person may act according to the judgment in all sincerity. There's nothing immoral about that action. The judgment of conscience means set up as a standard, a measure against which I must stand, and then I disregard it and act against that judgment, then that is an immoral act. So there's a process of conscience in general. Let's now look at the various stages of that and spell out the details of it. I'm going to give you three general principles. They are very general and they're self-evident, these principles. That means if we grasp the reality involved, we must agree with this principle. I'll give you a very simple example of something that's self-evident. If we understand what a whole is, W-H-O-L-E, and a part, it's self-evident that a whole is greater than a part. There's a very, very simple example of a self-evident principle. If we understand what's involved, we can't escape the truth of the principle. Let's look at the three principles that cover the whole moral field that are self-evident. The first is, murder is evil. If we grasp the reality of murder, the taking of the life of a fellow human being for some satisfaction or some selfish advantage, we recoil in horror. We know it is evil. We know it's destructive not only of the person, but of the one who performs that act. It's self-evident. The next principle, The principle of fairness, justice. To live as human beings, we need to have relationships with one another. We're dependent upon those relationships. If there's no trust in our relationships, life can become a crazy nightmare. And when some societies slip into that frame of mind, life is a nightmare for people. We recognise that in our dealings with one another, we should deal fairly. If we take an advantage of another person because we're more powerful or we're in control of more information or whatever it is, this is unjust. It is against this basic principle. In families, in school, in classrooms, one of the first things you hear, it's not fair. See, already children are recognising this principle of fairness, of justice, of dealing with one another, always according to a fair, equal standing. And then finally, the last principle is to do with our sexual life. The principle is that sexuality brings a great responsibility. If we really understand, take seriously what human sexuality is, the giving of a man and woman to one another in what is the most intimate and complete act of self-giving, is such a sacred thing. People come together and share their lives at a level that has no compare. Anyone who understands what human sexuality is knows that it involves a great responsibility. So there we have three principles that are self-evident. If we really understand what's involved, we know that we're confronted with right and wrong. Now let's look at moral science, applying these principles. Those principles I've given you are very, very general, and they have to be applied. Take the first one, murder is an evil. We all accept that principle. But where do you draw the line between a lawful taking of a life and an unlawful taking of a life? Is it ever lawful to take the life of another human being? In self-defense, for example, if I'm going to be killed, if I don't defend myself, eliminate the other person, am I able to respond? In warfare, is warfare lawful? Modern warfare has evolved, and it's reaching a point where many people hesitate to accept the responsibility of even participating in modern warfare. Total war, no rules, disregard of rules, obliterating whole populations, those sort of things. Here we're meeting very complex questions. Modern medical procedures. Now we have procedures where life can be sustained and continued. Is it wrong to withdraw that extraordinary means of support for the life? Then capital punishment. Even within our Catholic tradition, there's been a shift. When the first edition of the Catechism of the Catholic Church was published, many people weren't happy. It permitted capital punishment. It saw it was lawful in certain circumstances. In a later edition, this was greatly modified. Human sexuality, how complex the situations of people. When we recognise the responsibility, the great responsibility and the great benefits and values of human sexuality, to accept that principle, then apply it to all the complexity of human life, here we enter into a great field. And the question of justice, I'll give you an example. Say I have a car, and there's something wrong with this car. Once I reach 80 or 90 K, it gets a vibration. And I take it to the mechanic, and he says, well, there's something badly wrong with this car. It's going to be very expensive to put that right, so I'm going to sell the car. So I advertise the car. The person who comes along with their checkbook and likes to look at the car and is about to buy it, do I have to tell that person about the defect of the car? Well, even ancient Roman law said, let the buyer beware. If I prevent him from testing the car, I'd be taking unfair advantage of him. What about the complexity of commercial life today? There are whole departments of universities studying company law. We hear of court cases that go on for months. We enter in a tremendously complex field. So So obviously, the question of moral science, the application, which begins, as I said, in tribal societies. All tribal societies have laws about homicide, justice, and marital and sexual life. All societies, because the basic principles demand that directives and laws be made. But then the application becomes extremely complex. Notice also, as we to consider this judgment of conscience, most people associate conscience with something that confronts us after we've acted. We feel guilty. The guilt and uneasiness we feel after having acted. But if you followed my analysis, the essential judgment of conscience precedes the action. If I have acted against my conscience, then it's not surprising that afterwards there is remorse and unhappiness and discomfort. If I acted according to my conscience, then this mood after will be different. Also, another important thing to recognize about this judgment of conscience is not only whether an action is right or wrong, but how seriously right or wrong is it? We've looked at the process of conscience. We looked at the three phases of the process, the self-evident principles, moral science applying the principles, and then the judgment of conscience. Let's now look at some of the practical implications of the analysis we've made. And this will help us to get a grip on it as far as our own personal life is concerned. First of all, we must not confuse conscience with feelings and emotions. If I sold my car and I'd prevented the person having a test drive in order to get a good check out of him, well, afterwards I'd feel pretty miserable, wouldn't I? I'd feel degraded, unhappy with myself. Those feelings are not conscience. They are a consequence of conscience. Normally those feelings support conscience. Normally they echo the reality of conscience, but they are a very crude guide. Some people, it's sexual matters, have very strange feelings. If they took those feelings of shame or whatever as their guide of conscience, they'd be completely misled. On the other hand, some very evil people, people who perform extremely evil and destructive acts, may feel no remorse whatsoever. So it's very important to recognize it's not the feelings, it's the judgment. This is an important question because Sigmund Freud, one of the founders of modern psychology, he made a lot of these feelings, which he called the superego. See, for Freud, the ego was the person who is in charge of their life and reacting consciously. The superego is like something imposed on that, which is the echoes of our childhood formation. If we grew up in an environment where people said, now, but you be good, now you sit down here and tidy your room and don't you do that, and this is very naughty and this is shameful and whatever, all those things echo in our minds and they are like an imposition that can affect our whole reaction of shame and responsibility and so forth. We've got to distinguish between that and the genuine judgment of conscience. Unfortunately, Freud didn't do that. So he tried to solve people's problems at the emotional level, whereas the emotional level really presupposes that other level of understanding, rationality, which makes us out the human beings that we are. Another very practical thing, as far as your own life of conscience is conscience is about the good, not about wrong things. Though, again, in popular understanding, the whole emphasis is upon wrong things, isn't it? If our conscience life is merely avoiding committing sins, we're only babies morally. We don't grow. We don't get very far. Think about our basic principles. They're really about goods, values that are important. And if we embrace those values, that lay behind those principles, then we grow. There's the real development of conscience, that we embrace the values that underlie those basic principles. Murder is evil. Why? Because life is so precious. So a person who really has accepted the value of human life is respectful of human life at every stage. As we embrace those values, we grow. Our whole moral stature develops. And then justice. If we recognize that justice is really respecting the rights and the dignity of other people, if when we deal with other people, we are aware of their dignity, of their rights, and it's second nature to us to uphold their rights, never take advantage of them, never put them down, then we're growing as human beings. Made in the image of God, we're growing in that image. And then in human sexuality, all the wonderful blessings that come from a wholesome family and sexual life. Now, some people are uneasy about all this talk of conscience. And I've had someone once when I was giving this talk say, well, that's all right talking about conscience, but does God's law bind us or not? But what he's saying is God's law comes to us through conscience. It's through conscience, through that judgment we make, that each person has to make, that we have access to God's law. We don't have any special revelation. We have to listen to the authorities, those who are the bearers of truth and wisdom and value in our society, in our life, in our church. We have to follow these things. But in the end, it is through the judgment of conscience that these things will come to us. Remember, we'll be judged according to our lights. In the end, as a person makes their judgment of conscience, they are alone in a certain sense. All the truth that God's given us and all accessible to us all comes to us through conscience. This is an important thing because in past ages, paternalism was very common in human societies. Paternalism is authorities taking over the judgment of people. It's quite right to take over the judgment of a child. A good parent really is there and participates in the little judgments being made by the child as they're being formed in their character. But a mature human being has to make their own judgments. Cardinal Newman agrees with what I've just said. There's a passage from his letter. He first of all discusses wrong ideas of conscience. For example, he says, conscience is not a long-sighted selfishness. It's not a desire to be consistent. And then he goes on to point out how conscience always puts us in the presence of God in a certain sense, for all people. Conscience is a messenger from him who both in nature and in grace speaks to us behind a veil. In other words, the truth that challenges us, the truth that we meet in conscience, is God's truth. Then he goes on to say, conscience is the Aboriginal vicar of Christ. All that Christ stands for comes to us through conscience. There's Newman's idea. And all of this is accepted by the Second Vatican Council. Conscience is the most secret core and sanctuary of a person. There the person is alone with God, whose voice echoes deep within them. Newman speaks about the supreme authority of conscience. The primacy of conscience is perhaps a misleading phrase, as if it stands above God's law, it's in opposition to God's law. Well, I've explained it's in no way opposition to God's law. It mediates God's law, it brings God's law to us. But it is, in the end, has its own uniqueness in our life, in the making of our decisions. In its teaching on conscience, the Council says, in our life of conscience, we Christians join humanity in the search for truth. In the search for truth, many frequently err. But the Council says, by invincible ignorance. That's a technical term for moralists. It means an ignorance we can't overcome in our circumstances. Even if it errs, the Council says, conscience does not lose its dignity. People Their wholesomeness as moral persons depends upon whether they act according to their lights. Cardinal Newman, again, speaks of this difficulty of the process of conscience, its subtlety, and how easy it can go astray. The sense of right and wrong is so delicate, so fitful, so easily puzzled, so subtle in its argumentative methods. This sense is at once the highest of all teachers, yet the least luminous. So he honours conscience and says it's absolutely fundamental to human life, yet he acknowledges it's a flickering light for many people, and in the end many people err. Well, where does that leave us? Thomas Aquinas gives us what he calls the principle of goodwill. If we can kneel down humbly before God and say, I'm seeking the truth, I really want to live the truth, I've weighed up all the aspects of this question and all my responsibilities and its complexities. I've listened to those who teach and those who are wise. And in the end, I make this decision, knowing that I could be wrong, but I make it honourably and humbly before you, open to learning, ready to learn if I have more to learn. If we can make our conscious decision in that spirit, then that is a wholesome act of conscience. We're acting in good conscience, Aquinas says. A very, very important principle. So Newman again says, active conscience must follow upon serious thought, prayer, and all available means of arriving at the right judgment. When you can honestly say that, and I'm seeking the truth, before God now I make my decision, we can say we're acting in good conscience. This is important. We're not only judge before our conscience, but we're also responsible for our conscience. We must be truly open to the truth. Let's now look at some of the factors that disturb conscience. To understand our own conscious life, we should be aware of the things that disturb conscience. And first of all, severe emotional disturbance. A person who is overwhelmed by anger or fear may do things for which they're not responsible. We all know that. But a person who has a psychiatric breakdown, which make it very difficult for a person to assume their responsibilities, these greatly hamper the functioning of conscience. And then anxiety states. People are hamstrung by these states. Scruples are a form of anxiety. Scruples are an anxiety that lets on whether I've done wrong. Far more practical for most of us is subtle emotional disturbance. Most of us probably have had a bump in the car at some time. And as we're driving home, we prepare our story. There are terrible drivers on the road. If only that person hadn't come out so quickly, whatever. Find it hard not to be a bit biased, not put a spin on things. Or rationalisation. If we're in a privileged position, we tend to see things in a way that which will maintain our privilege. We will all have these kinds of pressures in making our conscious decisions, but it's realistic, it's human, we'll all have those kinds of pressures, yet if we can honestly make that decision of goodwill, all is well. We should be grateful that the Second Vatican Council affirmed the importance of conscience in our life today. It was most necessary in this changing situation of the world that we be reminded and encouraged to live by our conscience. As I said yesterday, paternalism was very widespread in society, in human society, and in the church, whereby people's decisions in a certain sense were made for them. And moralism. Those of us who are moral guides and teachers and pastors have to avoid the danger of falling into moralism. A moralist is a person who knows what's right and what's wrong and is very certain of it and feel very pleased with themselves for telling everyone about it. And we who are guides in the church and teachers and parents, we must learn from Christ, the great moral educator. Christ balanced a real concern, an openness, a supportiveness for people in their frailty, and the announcing of all the values that are God's values. He kept those two together. Think of that case in which the woman taken in adultery is brought before Christ by these hypocrites who are trying to find something against him. Not only about how he treated her, which was superbly beautiful, but the way he treated these people who had brought her. You know, he wrote on the ground and said, "Let the first one without sin cast the first stone." Gradually they left. And probably they were a little closer to a truly moral authenticity as they left. There's Christ, the moral educator. So the church has to find that balance, being able to help people take that next step in their journey of life. That's what Christ did. That's what the church should do. So the church has to avoid a moralistic stance that shows no understanding of the difficulties and challenges of people, and then a false compassion that doesn't really challenge people with the full truth of God's teaching and the church's teaching. We must recognise that the church's teaching has been extremely important for the whole world. In authoritative teaching in the church, some of that is what we call infallibly definitive. There's not much of that teaching. The teaching of the church has committed itself to irrevocably. And if you do not accept this, then you cannot have fellowship in the church. But apart from that, you have authoritative teaching that is not of that extreme kind. And down through the ages, that teaching has been extremely important for the well-being of the whole human family, that kind of teaching. In fact, there's no definitive, infallible teaching on moral matters. Many things are quite clearly beyond all doubt. But the church has never defined, in that ultimate sense, any moral matter. But obviously the church's moral guidance down through the ages has been extremely important, not only for the members of the church, but as a witness to the whole church. To find the truth and find this balance, we must have the Spirit of Christ. Only those who have the Spirit of Christ can teach in a way that leads people along the way of life. And only those who have the Spirit of Christ can hear the teaching of the church and find their way forward. I suppose a beautiful way to think of this, as we live our lives, listen to the church, is hear the voice of Christ beyond the faltering voices of people like ourselves who are giving guidance. The pastors, the teachers in the church giving guidance, we have faltering voices. If you listen with the Spirit of Christ, beyond that you'll hear Christ's voice. Let Christ's voice be your guide. I want to conclude now by referring to a pastoral letter of the Australian bishops in 1974, which made a great deal of conscience. In the aftermath of the encyclical Humanae Vitae about marital morality, the bishops had, immediately after the encyclical, issued a statement in which they agreed with the papal teaching and encouraged everyone to follow the papal teaching. But among the bishops, there were many who were not satisfied that that was helpful enough to people. So in 1974, they brought out another letter, which is of great importance. And it's a great pity it's not more widely known by our Catholic people. So first of all, they reaffirmed the Pope's teaching, and identified themselves with that teaching. Just a brief word on that. The basic Catholic teaching is that the relational aspect of sexuality and the life-giving aspect should not be separated. If you take the relational and leave the life-giving aspect out, then it's not full sexuality, if in some artificial way you prevent that. On the other hand, if you take the life-giving aspect and don't have the relationship, is a danger to the values of human sexuality. So there's a great wisdom in the church's stand. It's the application of that basic principle, really, that is very, very challenging. And before the Pope's encyclical, Catholic morals were not agreed. There was quite a wide range of views about how this new method of hormonal intervention in the life cycle could be integrated into Catholic morality. But Pope Paul VI took a stand on this and reaffirmed the basic principle and gave authoritative teaching. So the bishops identified with that, but then they noted the confusion that exists today in the whole world about the matter, and then within the church itself, because of the great debate that had gone on prior to the encyclical. So they stressed the role of conscience. In any consideration of this question, it's necessary to understand the role of conscience in moral guidance. Conscience for them is a practical judgment or dictate of reason by which one judges what here and now is to be done. They're identifying with the approach of Aquinas and Cardinal Newman. In the final analysis, conscience is inviolable. Conscience is the last norm and measure against which we must stand. It's not a law unto itself, must be open to the truth, and it's certainly not infallible, it may be mistaken. So it must involve an openness to a seeking of the fullness of the truth. Having said all these things, they then make this very important statement. It's not impossible, however, that an individual may fully accept the teaching authority of the Pope in general, may be aware of his teaching in this matter, yet reach a position after honest study and prayer that is at variance with the papal teaching. Such a person could be without blame. They would certainly not have cut themselves off from the church. Many people thought that if they didn't follow the encyclical, they had cut themselves off from the Catholic Church. They were hypocritical coming to church. Well, the bishop said it's a tragic error. They've not cut themselves off from the church. And acting in accordance with their conscience, they could be without any subjective fault. So the very clear statement, applying the principles that we've been discussing to this very important question of marital morality. Let's conclude with Cardinal Newman. Cardinal Newman, notice, he gives some examples here of people acting against papal teaching. They're not exactly the sort of teaching that Pope Paul gave, but the principle is the same. So let me read it for you. It seems that there are extreme cases in which conscience may come into collision with the word of the Pope and is to be followed in spite of that word. Was St. Peter infallible on the occasion at Antioch when St. Paul withstood him? There was a dispute between Peter and Paul. Peter had been eating with the Gentiles and not observing the Jewish practices of purity and diet and so forth. When some people criticised him for it, he discontinued that, and Paul challenged him. Clearly, Paul could withstand Peter, the first leader of the apostles. Pope Sixtus V blessed the Spanish Armada that was leaving to invade England in the name of Spain. Newman said clearly no Englishman would be agreeing with the Pope on that one. And then the Pope Urban VIII, who persecuted Galileo. Newman, he said, no Catholic ever pretended these popes were infallible in these acts. And he goes on to say, infallibility alone can block the exercise of conscience. Only an infallible teaching of the Pope, which puts some question absolutely beyond all doubt, can remove any possibility of dissenting in conscience. Newman's often been quoted with the words at the end of his letter to the Duke of Norfolk. It's a rather light-hearted way of summing up what he said, that conscience in the end has the supreme authority in our moral life in the way in which we've explained. So this is his light-hearted way of ending his letter. If I were obliged to bring religion into after-dinner toasts, which indeed does not seem to be quite the thing, I shall drink to the Pope, if you please, deal to conscience first and the Pope afterwards. So it's a very important question. A question that, because of the changing world, has become far more practically important in our Catholic life, and we should be grateful that the Second Vatican Council has given us a very strong and clear lead with regard to the importance of conscience in our lives.